indeed a very happy occasion for me to be part of this international panel. We are here to discuss the great space missions. When I saw the second panel, the starting of the panel discussions was by curiosity. Then I thought perhaps this is the most apt name for starting a panel. You know, it is curiosity brings us all of brings all of us here. So I will tell what I mean by that. Let me take it from here. So we are all familiar with this picture. It's a composition of various satellite imageries, and this shows a lot actually. This shows the entire human civilization. This shows what we all have, what we all are, and what we all are today. So what do we say? This is our world, our home. Now we look at the things in a slightly different perspective. Now, I request you to look at this picture. You see a circle there, and there is a small dot in the middle of the circle. That's our Earth. So, what we all are, what we all have, what look very big and what looks so glamorous and huge is actually a tiny dot in terms of the universe, and there's a lot more to it. So, very often we discuss, there's a lot of space in space. So, really a lot of space in space. And like Carl Sagan had said, consider that dot again, that's here, that's home. That's the little tiny bit where we are. But why I'm showing this is, there's a lot more to explore. There's a lot more to learn. And there is a curiosity to learn what is there elsewhere. So now that brings to the next slide. So we are talking about great space explorations. So let us just ponder, why do we explore? Because coming from a country like India, I have faced this question quite a few times. Why do we explore? Why do we need to do exploration? We even scratch our heads and think, yeah, why do we do it? Quest to discover. We try to discover something new. Thirst of knowledge. We want to know. You know, we always want to know more. Understand and comprehend. Once we know more, we try to understand why it is like that, and then we comprehend it properly. And just plain curiosity, or is it just that we want to know what is happening? Curiosity. So that's why I said curiosity. You know? And now I bring the next point. According to me, this is the most important. What happened elsewhere is waiting to happen here. I heard once upon a time there was a very good atmosphere around Mars, and now it has disappeared. So perhaps that can happen elsewhere also. So we are seeing so many different climatic changes in our world here. So we don't know, we don't have answers for everything. We are trying to understand. So instead of waiting for things to happen here and to find out how to eradicate it or how to face it, how to mitigate it, better be prepared. We try to find out why and what has happened elsewhere and apply it to our Earth and see if we gain more knowledge and become more knowledgeable to comprehend things that are happening there. And then be prepared and understand ourselves better. Now coming back to ISRO's Mars Orbiter mission, I'll just dwell upon a few seconds on the word Mangalyaan. So Mangalyaan means in Sanskrit, Mangal is the name given to the planet Mars, and Yaan is the vehicle. So the vehicle used to go to Mars is quite literally Mangalyaan. So that's what Mangalyaan is all about. And we call it as MOM, Mars Orbiter mission. Now, we have a different kind of objectives. There are technological objectives and scientific objectives. Amongst the technological objectives, we had the objective of actually to be, whether we are in a position to be able to design such a spacecraft at all. Let me remind you, ISRO is doing this for the first time. And it's a big challenge. So whether we are able to do it all by ourselves, in a very indigenous manner, design and realize this kind of a spacecraft, and what all it has to do? It has to encounter the atmosphere of Earth. Then there is a phase where it moves away from the sphere of influence of Earth and travels all the way to Mars. And then it has to encounter atmosphere of Mars. So for an organization which has never done any such thing, this was a real challenge. And to prove ourselves that we could do it was one of the main objectives. And then along with it comes the deep space communication, navigation, mission planning, and management of this kind of a mission. These are all challenges that we have to face to do any kind of interplanetary mission. Then, incorporate autonomous features to handle contingency. We will talk about autonomy slightly later. Like right now, we'll leave it at that. We have incorporated quite a few autonomous features, and why and how it is, I will talk about it. And then comes the more important scientific objective. The scientific objective is to study about the Mars' surface features, the morphology, mineralogy, and the atmosphere in general. So to show you how the Mars spacecraft looks like, this is the deployed artistic impression of the Mars spacecraft that we made. So you can see the propellant tank. This is basically various parts of the spacecraft. It had a dry mass of 485 kgs and a liftoff mass of 1337 kgs. And another view of the spacecraft. This is another view. I will go into details of all those individual things slightly later in the next slide, in fact. Okay. These are the various payloads we had on the Mars mission. We had payloads to study the atmosphere of Mars. Next is to study the surface of Mars. And third is to study the particle environment. These are the three major categories in which we had payloads. Right from our high school, we all have learned that organic chemistry, the world is made of organic chemistry, and carbon and hydrogen are the building blocks of life. So if we find them, then we may think that there is something more to it, and maybe life was there earlier. So in that direction, we had an alpha photometer, which was used to study the presence of hydrogen in Mars. And more specifically, not on Mars surface, but in Mars atmosphere. Like we heard earlier, he said that there were streams of water in Mars, and now there are no streams, only the stream bed is there. So we need to know where the water disappeared and what had happened. Perhaps we'll have an answer to that in due course of time. And then next is the methane. Where there is carbon, there methane will also be there. So the presence of methane, we have to just check whether the methane is available there. So we had a sensor to find out methane presence in Mars. And then the Mars color camera. Imaging, of course, is what should I say, the output which a common man can see and decipher. And it gives a lot of information about the surface features of Mars. So we had a color camera, thermal infrared spectrometer, and then we had a neutral composition analyzer for particulate analysis. So these are the various experiments that we had on Mars. Now, these may not look as too big or too complicated payload, but let me tell you, they were all indigenously developed in ISRO in India. And it was a big challenge to develop all these things and get them working right the very first time. So it was a major challenge for us. Now I'll talk to you about what this spacecraft looks like and how it is made actually. This is the basic structure. This structure is similar to any small satellite. It's 1.5 meter cube. It's a carbon composite based structure. And then we have adapted it. We have what is called as I1K bus. It's a bus for the satellites which weigh around 1000 kilograms of mass. So we have adapted that bus to suit the specific requirements of this particular mission. And then we had a thermal control system, both active and passive thermal elements. Now a word about thermal management. While we have the active and passive thermal elements within the spacecraft, we also need to do, in this kind of interplanetary exploration, some maneuvers to see that the solar load is managed. One is to be able to manage the thermal load within the spacecraft, and other is to see that load doesn't come inside from out from the solar source, and the third is to see less load comes from the source. So for that we do various kinds of maneuver. For example, when we are in the earthbound orbit, we were doing the roll pointing to sun. That is, always the roll axis of the satellite will point to the sun. That will ensure that the sun load is minimized at the other critical areas. Then next is the heliocentric phase. When the journey begins from Earth to Mars, we have this kind of an orientation. Again, this is to ensure that the solar load is controlled. Similarly, when it's in Mars orbit, there are two kind of positions in which we had the spacecraft. The first one is the majority of the time, but then we had a star sensor. When the sun tries to get into the star sensor's field of view, we need to rotate it again. So all these are thermal management techniques. And then we had deployment mechanisms. As you are aware, most of the appendages of any spacecraft are stout. and then they are deployed. They are stowed because we have to contain the entire body of the spacecraft within the rocket envelope, and then we have to deploy it once we go to orbit. So we had two deployment appendages. One is the 2.2 meter diameter reflector, and other is the solar panel deployment. The solar panel had a new thing in this kind of satellite. For a small bus, we had three solar panels and we had a dual deployment. So this was new for us. And then the propulsion system, we had used heritage propulsion elements, the monomethyl hydrogen and mixed oxides of nitrogen. These are the fuel and oxidizer that we used. And there were 12 small engines, 22 liter thrust engines. And there was one large 440 Newton liquid engine, which helped us in the travel from Earth to Mars. We will talk about it slightly later. Then we did extensive testing of all these elements. One of the challenges was we had to see that these elements work after being dormant for a long period. I will tell about that also. Then the power system. We had the three solar panels, as I told you. We generated 840 watts of power. Then we had a 36 ampere lithium ion battery to support the power requirements during various phases of the mission. And before I go to this slide, one of the tricky part was the power generation when the satellite is near Mars is much less as to when it is near Earth. So we need to consider that phase to actually design the power system. That was one of the important things that we had to consider. Then the attitude, orbital and control systems. We had a control electronics with this processor. This is a very well-known famous processor. And then there were star sensors and sun sensors. And then these four wheels that you're seeing are the reaction wheels, which will give the momentum biasing required. And then the 22 Newton and 440 Newton liquid engines that I told you. Then the communication system. As you would all know, this kind of an interplanetary mission, the communication is always a challenge. It requires to communicate with the spacecraft when it is in the Earth phase, the motion from Earth to Mars, and also in Mars phase. And the farthest it went was 375 plus million kilometers. So that was a real challenge. So we had a very robust communication system with a high power amplifier and a very sensitive receiver on board to receive the feeblest and faintest of signals from Earth. Now I talk to you about major challenges. This slide is prepared basically Director General Mission Space Agency was very particular that we explain these things in this August gathering. We had to accommodate a large quantity and size of hardware within I-1 cables. We chose a small bus and we had to locate and accommodate everything in that. I say small bus because we had the launch vehicle in mind, PSLV. So we had to make a satellite to suit PSLV. So that was one of the important challenges that we had. Then, as I told you, the restarting of the main liquid engine after a long dormant phase, after 300 days, it was doing nothing, it was going in space, and then when it reaches Mars, it had to fire. And it had to fire, there is no half ways about it, it has to do the job it is intended for. So that was a big challenge. We did extensive testing on ground to prove ourselves that it will work. Then managing power generation, I told the variable power generation and how to manage that. And then communication with the spacecraft, we have touched upon that also. Optimization of cost. Now, we have realized this mission in a cost of $75 million. So that, I think, is a real marvel. And I will touch upon a little bit more about how we did that. And to be able to do an interplanetary mission at this kind of a cost is really something. And then we had enhanced onboard autonomy. I told you enhanced onboard autonomy is required because of the complicated nature of the mission, and I will briefly touch upon what we mean by that. And the choice of components. So we encounter a very stringent radiation environment, and it has to sustain all this environment, so we had to choose the right kind of components for this. And we did all this for the first time, and a lot more things for the first time. Now, the first one that I was talking about is, as you can see, that is the heat shield of the PSLV launch vehicle, the PSLV rocket. And we have to design a satellite which can fit within that. And what all we wanted to put had to be within that. So accommodating that in that kind of a fashion and then have a thermal management of that kind of a small place was a big challenge. And why we chose PSLV was to be economic again. Then meet the mass and volume requirements. One was the volume, other is the weight. PSLV has got a constraint in terms of weight, and then we have to be within that. Now we have talked about the cost effectiveness of this particular mission. So how we did it, these are the ways that we are adopted to achieve this kind of a cost effective mission. One is choosing the PSLV launch vehicle itself. Being our own indigenous launch vehicle, it's a versatile workhorse kind of a launch vehicle for us in our space program, and with that we could cut down on cost. Working out an optimal mission strategy. If we had chosen a more powerful launch vehicle and perhaps gone out and procured this launch, then we would have got a more simpler spacecraft and concentrated more on the spacecraft. But we wanted to really use PSLV, and within its constraint we had to work out our mission. So that was one of the important things that we did, and by that we could cut down on cost. Use of heritage system. We didn't embark on doing some new kind of electronic packages and things like that. We took the existing proven qualified packages and we slightly adapted them to this mission, so that we didn't embark on doing something very novel and new. Avoiding multiple hardware. When we do, in spite of trying to avoid new hardware, we will eventually need something which is new because of the payload. So when we had to do something new like that, we didn't go for an experimental package, then qualification model, then flight model, then prototype model, and different kinds of packages to build reliability and build confidence. There we took a calculated risk. We avoided multiple packages. We went straight with a lot of testing and one model. And perhaps God was with us, and we could do it well with one model. And but that really cut down the cost. Then we prioritized and executed a large chunk of work. Generally we have a good space industry base in India, helping us in various space programs. But this particular project hardware, we decided that we're going to do majority of work within in-house, with close monitoring of schedules and hardware deliverables. So we had a very strict control on the schedule. And lastly, in this slide, the most important according to me, extended hours of dedicated workforce. Throughout this mission, throughout this project, a dedicated workforce was working well beyond 12 hours, well beyond 15-16 hours a day. That's the kind of dedication these people have worked, and then we got the fruits of that kind of dedication. So choose choice of PSLV, the optimal mission strategy, the heritage model, and then the in-house working of realizing various packages, monitoring things very carefully, and putting in a lot of effort. These are reasons for this mission being so cost-effective. And as someone said, we all know necessity is the mother of invention. But then someone added to this, constraint is the mother of frugal innovation. So if you have too many constraints, then you try to do a bit more and perhaps come out with frugal innovation. That's how we turned out to be an economic mission. Now we come to the enhanced autonomy. The Earth to Mars round trip. The round trip takes about 42 minutes. So if we decide that, okay, let us get telemetry, we will see, we'll look at the telemetry and then decide what to do, then again another 21 minutes are gone, and then we don't know what else can happen. So there is no scope for ground intervention at that particular moment. So onboard autonomy is a must. So we need to micromanage the mission, and for that onboard autonomy is required. For that, I'll go to the next slide. For that we had a fault detection, isolation and recovery kind of a system, FDIR, and we had a master recovery sensor. We had an E-square prompt, electronically erasable memory, and then we had the various AOCS logics. This is the block diagram, this is how it works. So what we basically did was, we had a continuous watch, we in the sense, the system was built to have a continuous watch. Then fault detection, the fault would be detected, isolated, reconfigured, and all this when earth pointing is ensured and throughout all phases of the mission. So this was the onboard autonomy that we achieved. Then radiation environment. We can't talk enough about radiation and hazards of radiation. And we just now heard about the kind of radiation doses we are seeing in Mars. And even on the way to Mars, there is enough radiation hazard. So to withstand all this, we had a selection of the right kind of components and right kind of radiation shielding. Now I'll touch upon the various sequences of realizing the spacecraft. We start with the open mode test, that is all the hardware is available, they are all just kept open all around, and then we link them up electronically and then do the test. After that we close the panels and repeat the test, then we go to the thermovac test. And being, I told you that we had adopted a single model philosophy, we did a very extensive thermovac test. And in addition to the thermovac test, where we ensured that all the systems are working in the extremes of temperatures and under vacuum, we did what is called as thermal balance test. This thermal balance test, in addition to imposing the conditions of extreme temperatures and vacuum, we also impose the sun load. The solar load is also imposed onto the spacecraft, and then for the various modes in which it is expected to work, it is tested. And then we come out of the thermovac, then we assemble our appendages, and then we do the deployment test for the solar panel as well as the spacecraft. Then the CGMI, we measure the physical parameters of the spacecraft. Then we do a radiation test once the satellite is ready. And now the satellite is declared as ready for shipment. Satellite is moved to the launch base and we fill the satellite with propellants. Then it is ready for assembly with the rocket. It will look like this. Just before closure and saying final bye to the satellite, it is encapsulated within the PSLV. It looks like this. And then we have this launch. Now this particular picture is very important. You see the three youngsters. This is rural India. Okay. Our launch base is in a place called Srihariko, and it is surrounded by a rural area. And in that rural India, we have some three youngsters very eagerly looking at this launch. Perhaps this is one of the important things that we achieved. With the Mars mission, what we achieved was getting the youth of the country ignited and inspired to know more about space. We'll talk about it a bit more. Then now we'll talk about the actual launch. Launch took place on 5th of November last year. In 2013, we used a high performance variant, we call the PSLV XL, that is a high performance variant of PSLV, and these are the various parameters of the launch vehicle. And then to track the last stage of PSLV and the satellite, we used two shipborne terminals. That was one of the first, that is the first time that ISRO has done such a thing. I will show you a picture of that, what we had exactly done also. The launcher would place the satellite in 250 kilometers by 23,000 kilometers orbit. It is not much, but it gives the important push, the velocity, the delta V that is required for the satellite to be moving there. And let us see what happened after that. So this is how the satellite path looks like. The purple path you see is the rocket path. And at particular point, the rocket path stops, the rocket mission is over, and then the satellite starts moving around. So we had a ground segment to support and track the satellite as well as the rocket, and we had our own deep space network to track the satellite in the deep space mission phase, and we had the international ground stations helping us in tracking this. And at a particular point in the Pacific Ocean, we didn't have any earth station to track the satellite and the rocket. That is where we positioned two ships to monitor the movement of the rocket and the satellite. This is how it looks like. And looking from the almost, what should I say, east of Australia, or from South Pole, that kind of a place, when you see, there is a blank where we don't have any earth station. So to manage the monitoring of the satellite and the launch vehicle, we positioned two ships there. That was a major thing which we did for the first time. So once the rocket has ejected the spacecraft, we had all these things. We will go to the graphics straight away. So what happened is, the satellite is left in the 23,550 kilometers orbit, which I showed you. And after that, the closest point to Earth is called perigee. The farthest point to Earth is called apogee in the elliptical orbit. So each time it comes to perigee, there is one firing. Like that, we had a 6 series of firings, and then each perigee firing will increase the apogee. So we gradually increased it to what you see there. Those are the numbers. We increased it there. What happened there? After that, still the satellite is in the Earth's sphere of influence. It's called SOI, Earth's sphere of influence. At that point of time, after we achieved the targeted apogee, we gave it a delta V boost. We gave it a push kind of a thing. Again, the the liquid engine will be fired, and then the satellite will start going out of the Earth's sphere of influence. This is very similar to what we saw earlier in the last presentation, because going to Mars, these are the things we need to do. So the green line that you see, that is the trajectory. The satellite starts moving in that trajectory. The blue line is the Earth's orbit, and the yellow line is the Mars orbit. Mars was there at when the satellite departure had taken place, and then Mars is moving down the line, and then the satellite goes in the green trajectory and goes and joins Mars at that particular point there. What happens there, we will see slightly more detail. So what happens there is, it goes, this is too much of information in the slide, I'll go to the next one. Yeah, this is better. See, once the satellite reaches the Mars orbit, it is very close to that, then we reorient the satellite. The satellite is turned so that we cannot have the engines in wherever we want. We have it in one particular axis. So we need to orient it in such a way that that axis is pointing towards the direction in which we want the deceleration. So once that is done, at that particular point where the orange part of the curve starts, the deceleration begins, the engine firing starts. So what is important here is, let me read out a couple of points which are of interest. See, once the engine starts firing, just before the engine starts firing, we have Earth visibility. We have visibility to Earth. Once it starts firing, it is under eclipse. We cannot see that. So everything has to work well. And then the burn starts when mom is speeding at, just to give you some numbers, it's around 5.127 kilometers per second relative to Mars. Then the overall burn is for 24 minutes. Basically, we are decelerating it. What was moving like this is suddenly stopped like that. And then during the burn, the lowest altitude spacecraft reaches is as close as 462 kilometers from Mars. So what I'm trying to say is the satellite has to go through all kinds of phases and face different kinds of atmosphere. Then I told you about the communication blackout. And then once the firing is done, then we turn back the satellite, and now it is in Mars' sphere of influence. So with this, we have reached Mars, into the Mars orbit. And this being the Mars orbiter mission, it has achieved what we intended to do. Now what happened next? Now we'll talk about the working of this particular spacecraft. It's just started working, and last September we had put it into the Martian orbit, and now a lot of data is coming from there. I will show you some of the data, and a lot of science has been collected. I say science is being collected in because I don't want to call it data, because a depth of knowledge is there in the data. And as I speak right now also, a lot of analysis is going on the data that is collected, and we believe a lot of new things are waiting to be discovered. And now we'll go to what we got from there. So this, I showed you a Mars color camera. These are the different kinds of images that that camera sent us. And then Mars, as seen by Mars orbiter mission, I said you we are studying the surface also, so it gives you an idea of the surface. Remember, this is being done for the first time with our own camera. And then Mars has got two moons. One is Phobos, one is Deimos. So the black dot that you see on the right side picture, that is one of the moons. And then for an Indian to be able to see this kind of a video image through their own instrument at such a low cost is a real big achievement. It's a real sense of, what should I say, is a matter of pride. And then we had this comet sighting spring going very near to the Mars. So we had extensive discussions with NASA. They, with their Manhattan spacecraft, they were also observing this comet, and we were also observing this comet. We had a discussion, what they would do, what we would do. It was like sharing, you do this, we do that. And it was a real good cooperative effort. And then this is what the images look like. But as I told you, a lot more data is available, and analysis is going on to find out the scientific observations and what all these things mean. And this is one high-resolution image of Mars. This really gives a good picture of Mars and how it looks like.
we call this mission of many firsts because we did quite a few things for the first time, and let me quickly touch upon some of them. For India, this was the first interplanetary mission, and then first time we were taking a satellite out of the sphere of influence of Earth, and then for the first time any country has succeeded, the very first time. This was a real big first. And then this is supposed to be the most economical interplanetary mission. And then the first time we used the shipborne terminals, I showed you about that. Then this is one important thing that we did. We, right from the realization of Mars satellite, we were on the social media. We wanted people to get involved. We wanted to share what is happening. It is not like, we will not show you what we are doing. We will tell you later. It's not like that. Right from day one, we got the common man involved. We wanted to inculcate that interest from the, you know, the common public. And then we went social, and on the social media, we were there all over, and we gave a lot of information. And this was the first time that ISRO did such a thing, and it was a really fruitful experience. Now to conclude, we realized this mission at a meager cost of $75 billion. Then the project was achieved as per the planned schedule. There was no slippage. We planned, we targeted, and we achieved it. Then the team, it involved a majority of youngsters. The project director himself is less than 50 years old. He is not even 50. So it was that kind of a lot of youngsters were involved in the team. Guys who had just come out of college, they were also put on that. Guys with some experience, and really it was a very young team which did achieve this. Then there was some element of risk. I told you we had taken a single model philosophy, so there was an element of risk. But then we took it by choice, and the choice was to serve and not of self-interest. We wanted to serve and take this risk and see how it comes. And the most important outcome was great excitement. It created an excitement, an inspiration and motivation amongst the youngsters. We were having a discussion over lunch with Dr. Mendiga. We found that the youngsters no longer want to pursue science as a career. We see and hear of youngsters wanting to become lawyers, wanting to get into finance, you know, where the money is. But the interest quotient in the field of sciences is day by day coming down. So for a country like India, where there's a large young workforce, we thought by inspiring them to be interested in this kind of a mission, we will inculcate an interest for them to pursue careers in science. And then, of course, we have an international recognition now for the smartness with which we achieve this. That's it. Thank you.